Just into the First Alert Hurricane Tracking Center, a new tropical depression 19. This is the same area we were tracking yesterday and the day before that. It was that area of interest right on top of the Bahamas, the same area that's bringing us all this tropical moisture and the reason we have the flood watch in place for Saturday and now Sunday. Now it's found some rotation and it is a tropical depression, 35 mile per hour winds gusting up to 45, moving off to the west northwest at about 8 miles per hour. This is going to go right over our state. So we're going to break this down coming up in just a bit, but it's important to note that it does not increase its intensity until it's on the other side of our state and then heads into the Gulf of Mexico, where it finds a favorable environment before heading into north of the North Gulf of Mexico into the Panhandle or potentially into Louisiana. Closer to home, we are still dealing with rain, heavy rain, and these storms thankfully are pushing out into the Gulf of Mexico at a good rate, 10, 15 miles per hour. Some showers and downpours right along Port Royal. For the rest of this evening, a lot of these storms are going to continue their journey off to the south and west into the Gulf, but more rain is headed our way for Saturday and Sunday, enough for that flood watch in place. We'll get to the specifics and the latest on Tropical Depression 19 coming up.
With all that rain, flooding is possible. We've already seen a lot of rain in the last couple of weeks, and the ground certainly is saturated. And with the chance of a tropical system developing near our coast, Lee County road crews are getting ready, clearing debris from ditches, swales, and drainage systems to handle the extra water.
When it floods, we don't usually go anywhere. I mean, you know, if we're going in the truck, okay, but I can't take my car out or I'll get stuck.
To report a clogged ditch in your neighborhood, head to the NBC2 News app and look under News Links.
If there are any big weather developments this weekend, NBC2 will let you know first. With a push alert just like this, it'll get sent right to your phone.
She came through the back window that was broken, and we just put our hands on him. We were told not to move him, so we just put our hands on him and started to pray.
A Good Samaritan describes the moment she tried to save a 7-year-old boy critically injured in a car crash. The boy's mother was behind the wheel when troopers say she collided with a truck along US 41 and Pondella Road in North Fort Myers.
Neither of them were wearing a seatbelt. Tonight, NBC2's Emilia Fabiano spoke to the woman who tried to help, but in the end could only pray that the boy survives.
It's been almost 2 days since that horrible crash here on US 41 and Pondella Road. A woman I spoke to today tells me she'll never forget what she saw that night.
It was a lot of chaos, especially with everybody saying there was a baby. That's just everybody was just so panicked about the child.
As a grandma and a mom, Lisa Moore recalls the moment she knew she had to help with this horrific sight.
He reminded me of my little grandson, the same age. And I just, it could have been, you know, my little grandson back there.
A 7-year-old boy badly hurt in this crash in North Fort Myers Wednesday night. His mom was driving their car on 41 when she went through a red light.
Driver in question was initially stopped for that red light and at some point, for some reason, then proceeded to travel through the red light. And that's when the crash occurred.
Investigators say she crashed into a truck coming over on Pondella Road and another car as well. Both she and the boy were not wearing seat belts. Moore says she and another woman climbed into the wreckage to help.
She came through the back window that was broken, and we just put our hands on him. We were told not to move him, so we just put our hands on him and started to pray. The mother was, you know, disoriented. I mean, she really took a hard hit as well.
Both the mom and her son were rushed to Lee Memorial Hospital. A dog in the car with them also suffered gruesome injuries. Today, that little boy is at Tampa General Hospital in critical condition.
We wish we could do anything in this world to make him better and at this point, and that's why we're, you know, being so outspoken about the importance of making good decisions in a car when you're behind a wheel and staying buckled up.
You know, I've kind of been in a, you know, cloud, just worried about him and his mom. Yeah. I just pray for both of them. Strap your babies in. Yeah. You could save their life.
An FHP spokesperson tells me the driver at fault may be facing a citation, but right now they're just wishing her a speedy recovery as she remains in serious condition tonight. Reporting in North Fort Myers, Emilia Fabiano, NBC2.
Several people, including a student, are recovering from injuries after a school bus and car collided in Charlotte County. This happened at Twin Lakes Drive and US 41 in Punta Gorda. 16 people were on the bus, one student taken to the hospital with a wrist injury. The driver of the car suffered severe injuries and was flown to Lee Memorial. We have some breaking news at 5. More than $313,000 in cash land three local men behind bars thanks to the state's newest drug task force. NBC2's Shannon Clough is in our studio as this makes for 44 arrests in the past week.
Kelly, so these three men right here are now a part of those 44 people, all suspects in this drug trafficking investigation. Right now, we want you to check out these pictures that we just got from the state attorney's office. So what you're looking at right here is money that authorities found in a Lee County storage unit. This unit belonged to a man who was arrested last week, a part of this investigation. So they found over $313,000, but that's actually not all the money. In this entire investigation, authorities collected $660,000. And then on top of that, there's more. They also found $649,000 worth of illegal drugs. So we want to show you the most recent arrests. We have Juan Roll, who was arrested in Collier County, Alan Gary, who was arrested in Lee, and then Keenan Frederick, who was arrested in Broward. All three of them are now facing charges related to drug trafficking. I'm live in the studio. Shannon Clough, NBC2.
COVID-19 cases have been slowly going up this week in Florida. Today, the state reported another 3,600 new cases. We had less than 2,000 at the start of the week. It's a small sample size, so for now, it's nothing to worry about. We are still seeing the devastating effects from the big spike in cases earlier in the summer. The state just reported another 176 COVID-related deaths. 11 of those were from Lee, Collier, and Charlotte counties. Our hospitals are looking really good right now. Lee Health is reporting the lowest amount of COVID patients since April. Right now, they say they have 60 patients with the virus in their hospitals. Florida bars can reopen Monday. The state closed them when cases started to spike back in June. The CDC is warning that bars are one of the most likely places to spread the virus.
I think, you know, if somebody sits down, they're sitting there, they got their hands on the bar, whatever, somebody should be there pretty quickly to wipe that down before somebody else gets in there and sits down.
Make sure everybody's attentive and what you need to be doing and taking care of yourself and everybody else around you.
The CDC encourages businesses to prioritize outdoor seating and keep tables 6 feet apart.
More than 24 hours after Cape Coral police swarmed a home for a suspicious death, NBC2 is still trying to learn what happened. Here's what we do know. A neighbor heard someone screaming on the phone outside the Southwest 25th Street home right off Veterans Parkway. Crime scene tape was just taken down in the last several hours. NBC2's Ashley Dyer is outside that home as police continue to investigate.
Police spending more than 24 hours on scene collecting evidence, combing through the property. People we talked to saying they are shocked to see a death investigation in their neighborhood.
When we got home, there was a bunch of cop cars. The road was blocked off on both ends. They were like up and down the driveway, the cops looking at everything.
This Cape Coral home, the center of a death investigation.
It's going to be interesting to know what happened in my little quiet neighborhood.
Today, curiosity grows as questions surround this home and the people who live there.
It is a little weird because it is suspicious and it happened out of nowhere.
Samantha Quigley goes for walks every day with her daughter.
It's pretty like uneasy, especially having the kids.
She's seen the man who lives here a couple times, but says the only encounters she's had with him were awkward.
And he would like run out like of his house, shirtless, shoeless, with his hand in his phone in his hand and like get in the car and drive away.
Samantha says most people in the neighborhood are friendly.
Everyone else is just super friendly and super nice, and he was like the only one who I got weird vibes from, so I'm not totally surprised, but I don't really know what went on there.
Tonight we're working to find out who the victim is and if any arrests have been made. I'm in Cape Coral, Ashley Dyer, NBC2.
Well,
that guy caught on camera yelling at a Collier County stoplight in August is pleading not guilty to three charges. Detectives say Jeffrey Rouse went on a racist rant, then led them on a high-speed chase the day after. He's also accused of defacing political signs. His attorney was in court on his behalf today. He's expected back in court at the end of the month.
They call him Captain America in downtown Fort Myers. You can kind of see why based on his outfit. But now he's arrested after he was caught on camera ripping down that gay pride flag in the middle of the day outside the Standard restaurant. Witnesses say he then tried to attack the owner. Tonight, NBC2's Dave Elias is pulling the mask off this guy.
Well, according to this police report, a 38-year-old man draped in an American flag was walking here in downtown Fort Myers when he stepped up on this table and then ripped down this pride flag. What he didn't realize is that the whole thing was caught on video surveillance. Draped in an American flag, this man jumps up onto a dining table at the Standard restaurant.
The second time I caught him in the act,
he actually hangs from the flag before he unscrews it and then leaps to the ground and takes off, the owner not far behind.
He swung a metal rod at me. I stepped back and then I followed him from five steps behind all the way down to the marina before the police showed up.
38-year-old Jason Jock, charged by the Sheriff's Department with aggravated assault, property damage, and criminal mischief. This incident happened in Fort Myers, downtown. Why did you guys get involved?
They're a taxpayer in this county, so they have the right to request a sheriff's deputy, and we will respond. And that's what happened.
NBC2 discovering Jock has a history of arrest involving alcohol, drugs, and human trafficking.
Possibly he's now displaying some mental illness, is engaging the public, putting their safety at risk.
He's known to live here.
Yeah, that's Jason.
Among the homeless in Centennial Park.
We used to know him by Captain America because he used to have the flag on all the time, Captain America.
Now, this is the fourth time that the pride flag has been ripped down. The owner of the Standard says he thinks it was the same suspect every time. For now, the so-called Captain America remains behind bars tonight. Dave Elias, NBC2.
And it's liquid gold. I call it that liquid gold.
Get lost in the sauce. Tonight's story to share looks mighty tasty, only at 6.
Fraud reports are at a crazy high level right now, and it's really hard for regulators to keep up.
NBC2 investigates fake COVID cures and why scammers keep getting away with them.
With a new tropical depression, how does this change our forecast for the weekend? Your First Alert forecast coming up.
Let's hit the rewind button. Back to the beginning of Let's hit the rewind button.
I cannot tell you what it was like to be there.
We are 6 months into this pandemic, and scammers are not slowing down.
NBC2 investigator Evan Dean explains how they continue to fool us and keep getting away with it.
Let's hit the rewind button, back to the beginning of coronavirus.
The deal is more likely a scam. Those are scams. Scammers are doing just that.
Yes, we warned about the COVID scams.
I have not read any scientific evidence.
Hacks.
Never click on a link.
And fake cures long ago. But 6 months into the coronavirus, it is still painfully clear.
Fraud reports are at a crazy high level right now.
Take a look at the number of online fraud reports in the U.S. the first 6 months of 2019. Nearly 85,000 reports, totaling losses of $56.3 million. But the first 6 months of this year, there have been nearly 140,000 reports and almost $90 million out the window.
It's a hard number that really kind of jumps out and solidifies the issue.
That's Ryan Felton, an investigator for Consumer Reports. He found that scammers or companies offering bogus cures are playing shell games and are harder to trace than ever. And the ripoffs aren't always one and done for their victims.
They bought a product, they got a product, but with the scheme that they got ensnared in was they started receiving automatic credit card charges that they never signed up for from vendors they never heard from.
It's so difficult for the feds to bust all bad actors, so it's up to you to protect yourself. Three key tips in our online world: avoid odd links or attachments, keep an eye out for strange misspellings, and never fall for scare tactics.
If they don't even the slightest bit know where an email came from, offering a product, offering a service, they should take a moment and pause before they go forward.
For the NBC2 investigators, I'm Evan Dean.
Some of the youngest cancer patients in our area got a nice surprise this week. The Cancer Alliance of Naples had to cancel their summer retreat for the kids because of the pandemic. So they, with the help of Iona McGregor firefighters, surprised some children with goodie baskets this week. Each basket had toys and a gift certificate to the family's favorite restaurant. They did this in Fort Myers and Naples and plan to visit kids in Cape Coral soon.
Good thing the rain held off for the most part earlier so they could do that, but not for long, huh?
Yeah, we're going to have a lot of downpours for the weekend, and it's going to be kind of like what we've had this week with a little extra something for specifically on Saturday. Sunday is still a little bit questionable depending on how strong and where Tropical Depression 19 goes. Now, this really changed within 24 hours, and that's why we always say stay informed, stay up to date of what's going on with these tropical systems. Last night at 11, the National Hurricane Center had a 10% chance of this developing within the next 2 days. This morning, it started to bump up drastically, and here we go, less than 24 hours ago away, we have Tropical Depression 19. So this is going to slide off to the north and west and head back into the Gulf of Mexico. We're at 35 mile per hour winds, gusting up to 45. The pressure is at 1,009 millibars. So where does it go? And watch this closely because, yeah, we're in the forecast cone. Not a lot changes for us from what we've been saying for the past 2 days with what to expect this weekend. It does not have a chance, mainly because of land interaction, to really get to that tropical storm status until the weekend when it's into those Gulf waters. But look at this, 70 mile per hour winds. That is just shy of Category 1 status before making landfall near Louisiana potentially. So like I mentioned, not a lot changes for us. Heavy rain at times through Sunday, breezy specifically on Saturday, not so much on Sunday, and it doesn't get stronger until it enters the Gulf of Mexico. Those flood watches have been expanded for the entire region. A flood watch means, hey, there's the potential for some flooding, specifically in areas that have seen a lot of rain as of late. Now, who sees the most amount of rain really depends on how well organized the system becomes within the next 24 or even 36 hours. This is just one computer model pegging all of the rain right along the coastal spots. That's where the flood watches were initially before they were expanded inward, inland. Does that mean that areas in Immokalee cannot see over 2 inches of rain? No, we could definitely see near 2 inches of rain for areas inland, depending where those bands of rain set up. The biggest change with the forecast with Tropical Depression 19 forming is the wind forecast for Saturday. By Saturday afternoon, we're looking at wind speeds topping near 15 to 20 mile per hour sustained winds, gusting near about 25 miles per hour. Even through 9:30 at night, the winds will be back down to about 15 miles per hour. On Sunday, definitely not as breezy as it will be on Saturday. So Saturday will be your biggest impact as far as how strong those winds will be. As far as rain is concerned, we're going to walk you through the future cast coming up at 5:30. But for tonight, those downpours in the Cape Hayes Peninsula are pushing out into the Gulf of Mexico. And here we go, a few downpours. These are actually moving, unlike the past couple of days. Also into Sanibel, leaving Fort Myers Beach. Our strongest storm that was on top of Naples and Marco Island, already into the Gulf of Mexico as well. So scattered showers kind of inland for the rest of this evening, and we'll pick up those rain chances for tomorrow. It will turn drier. Some clouds will remain. 76 degrees tonight. For tomorrow, that rain could be heavy at times, on and off through much of the midday and then picking up a little bit during the afternoon. It's not an utter washout, but we will have those downpours. 86 on Saturday. And then Sunday's forecast, wait till coming up at 5:30. We're going to show you what we could potentially see on Sunday, the possibilities. So Sunday will go with rain and storms, of course, 90 degrees. That flooding potential continues. That's your First Alert forecast.
I cannot tell you what it was like to be there and see people holding hands as they fell to their death.
Tonight at 5:30, the free help now available to those who risked their lives on 9/11 and are now fighting their own health battles 19 years later.
It's been an eyesore for years, but next at 5, this bankrupt project is now getting new life in Collier County.
A Naples eyesore will soon get a makeover. The community has been waiting for years. The Bay Club project in Creighton Cove has been at a standstill.
But there's a new plan and more funding to finish the job. NBC2's Christy Soto spent the day at the site to see what we can expect.
Creighton Cove is known for its beautiful views, shops, and buildings. But over the years, they've had kind of an eyesore in this area. This project over here, it has been a visual nightmare for some, but soon they'll be getting a different look.
Well, here's my palette over here.
Artist Phil Fisher has been painting this slice of paradise he calls home for the last 13 years. But for the last 4 years, the view outside his studio has been anything but breathtaking.
But it's a real eyesore.
He is talking about the Bay Club development project. It's been in the works for several years. Due to bankruptcy issues, the project was put on hold. But now, with a new reorganization plan and $15 million in funding, they're one step closer to giving this eyesore a makeover.
We're hopeful that we can get there, and we think the plan we have proposed creates a good, viable outline to finish this project.
Once completed, this lot will be a luxury living development with 10 waterfront apartments, each including their own boat slip. The artist says he loves Creighton Cove's old Florida feel, but he's ready for something new.
Things have to change. We need this to get cleaned up.
Meanwhile, Jackie Jones, who grew up in Naples, has loved watching the city grow. She says one thing always remains the same.
The nice thing about Naples is, even as it grows bigger and bigger, it still maintains the small town reputation that we've always had.
Bay Club will have a hearing next week where they hope their plan for reorganization will be approved. There's no telling when the project will be completed, but the community is looking forward to its makeover. In Naples, Chrissy Soto, NBC2.
All new, ahead at 5:30.
The desperate search for survivors after a construction site collapsed in Atlanta.
Does it feel like it's been 19 years?
No.
9/11 still impacting the health of hundreds. Next at 5:30, the help to get their medical expenses paid for.